City Council Local Redevelopment Board for the City of Riverbank meetings are now in session. Today is January 11th, 2022. It is 6 p.m. This meeting will be held in accordance with the California Government Code Section 594. Where's my glasses? Yes, second. They printed a little hot, larger. 59453 subdivision echo of the Ralph and Brown Act, California Government Code 54950 et sec, the Federal Americans with Disability Act, and the recent Stanislaus County Health Officers Mandatory Face Covering Order September 2nd, 2022. While this meeting will be physically open to the public, given the state of emergency regarding the threat of COVID-19, members of the public may also participate and comment via Zoom virtual platform. Refer to the last page of the agenda for the participation information. Please rise.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Please remain standing.
Let us pray. Heavenly Father Jesus, as we come to you tonight, we ask that this meeting be conducted in a manner that's grateful for the citizens of Riverbank. We pray for each one, each and every council member and the mayor. We just ask Heavenly Father Jesus that you give them the ability to conduct themselves in a manner that would be beneficial to the city of Riverbank. Be with them on each item that they have to take up. Declare this something that would be worthy to you and something that you would honor. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
Amen. Amen. Please be seated. Roll call, please.
Council Authority Member District 2, Rachel Hernandez.
Here.
Council Authority Member District 3, Cal Campbell.
Here.
Council Authority Member District 4, Darlene Barber Martinez. I can see that you're on Zoom. You can't hear. Vice Mayor Chair Luis Uribe.
Here.
Mayor Chair Richard D. O'Brien.
Here. There will be no agenda changes for this evening. Conflict of interest, any council authority member or staff who has a direct conflict of interest on any scheduled agenda item to be considered is to declare their conflict at this time. Seeing none, we're going to move on to public comment. At this time, members of the public may comment on any item not appearing on the agenda and within the subject matter jurisdiction of the City Council LRA Board. Individual comments will be limited to maximum of 3 minutes, and time cannot be yielded to another person. Under state law, matters presented during the public comment period cannot be discussed or acted upon. Do we have public comment?
Charles Neal, 2312 Rio Verde Drive in Riverbank, California. The last council meeting, I said something to you about the Rio Arturo School and that traffic jam up there. And I talked to Cal Campbell, and I'm sure that he's going to do something with his school board, but I just would like for you guys to do something too. Maybe get involved with it and, you know, kind of send them on down Stanislaus Street or somewhere, because they come in that cul-de-sac, and there's two cul-de-sacs there, and they come around there and they're speeding, and then they just park anywhere they can. They'll block your driveway, they'll block you in. You know, everybody except me, they won't do that, because I'm out there telling them, you know, hey, either move it or I'll move it. But I just don't like to be out there, and I shouldn't have to be. There should be some way that they could dictate to those people, you know, because that is a traffic jam up there, and it is every afternoon between 2:30 and 3 o'clock, it is unreal up there. And every morning they have a pretty good traffic jam in there. And it's just not something that needs to be done. I mean, somebody needs to go in there and tell them, hey, you know, this is not some place that you venture to go and just park anywhere you want to. Thank you, guys.
Did you talk to the chief about that?
I've talked to the chief before, but I want to talk to Susan Taylor lives down the street from me. Just about to want to talk to him about it.
Good evening. My name's Dan Whetstone. I live on McHenry Avenue, between halfway between Stewart and River Road. Again, I want to talk to you about the River Walk project. It's coming down the pipe, so please keep it in mind. Please don't rubber stamp it. That's just such prime ag land out there. If Riverbank needs more housing, please consider the alternatives. Again, we're going to keep coming to you and reminding you to, you know, look at this with a critical eye. And we know the EIR is coming down too, so please look at that and consider, like I say, the alternatives. And hopefully you've gone out there and looked at that area. It's just beautiful, even this time of year without the leaves on the trees. It's just beautiful. So, again, thank you for your time.
Good evening. My name is Fred Walton. I live on Hogue Road. And I, too, wanted to talk about the development down below, the Riverwalk. I think one has to consider some of the problems that may arise from it. Sewer, traffic, flood, you know, maybe some kind of development. I mentioned ranchettes, something more suited for it, if you have to develop it. I think the high density more towards Coffee, Oakdale, Tully, Carver, Dale Road, high density back in that area. And there's different geography there. There's a river, and there's a river bottom, and then there's the bluffs there. And each would require a different type of housing project. So keep in mind that. Also, I've challenged all of you to drive out there. Take a look at it. Drive down on that river bottom. Go down and walk down to the river. See all the different geographies, drive up on the bluffs, and that way you can see it for yourself, and you can make a better decision when the time comes. Thank you.
Thank you. Other comment? No other comment? Okay, well, I'm going to do a public comment. This has to do with Mr. Scully. He came to us, in 2016? And during that time, you know, we were wanting to know if he was going to stay, so we gave him a 6 weeks contract, something like that, very short. We were reminded after a couple of years we should make it at least a yearly one. So we gave him a lengthy one this last time, and so he decided to leave us. When he took over, Maricela was already the interim city manager, taken over for Jill Anderson before Sean took over. And Jill gave Maricela this large manila envelope. And it was a note saying, use these envelopes when you need to. So he looks at it. There's number 1, 2, and 3. Well, we were having difficulties with the LRA transfer, and I got a little concerned. And I think I made a statement, which I probably couldn't have executed real well, but could have, was if you don't transfer this property, you're going to have to find a new job, or something like that. And so Sean immediately opens up number 1. And number 1 envelope says, blame your predecessor. And he did, so he got away with that. Couple of years later, I think we had an HR issue. It's pretty significant. And it could have really hurt this city. So he opens up envelope number two. And envelope number two says, reorganize. And you did. And that reorganization did excellent for the administration of the city. Now this last one that he's having issues with is with the Contadina plant. He told me it was going to be taken care of just like he did with the, not the LRA, it's Contadina plant, and also tax sharing. He said he can get this done. Well, he could not. So he opened up the third envelope and it said, prepare three more envelopes. Yeah, it did, it did. I was asked to comment on Mr. Scully, his professionalism. What were the single most important items of Mr. Scully? His quietness. Well, not really. If Mr. Scully's speaking, everyone hears him. He has a private office, but when he speaks, everyone hears him. He tells me, hey, this is a secret, don't tell anyone, but as he's telling me, everyone else hears it. He gave Maricela, I overheard him giving Maricela some advice, how to be a city manager. And some of you can probably validate this. When you go to a meeting, come late. That way, everyone would think that you have important things to do. Second item, when you're at the meeting, don't say anything for at least halfway through. Then when you speak, people think that you are intelligent. You have some meaningful words. Third, if there's a difficult decision, tell them to form a subcommittee. That way, you don't have to make the decision right there. You make other people make them for you. And then really, to get everyone liking you, you ask that the meeting be adjourned early. One of the best qualities of Mr. Scully is how promptly he calls back. Tell the mayor I'll call him back in 5 minutes. 3 days go by, I ask if I could speak to him, and he goes, I'll call him right back. This time I really will. And by the time he calls me back a week later, I've forgotten what the conversation was going to be about. But honestly, since you've been here, Sean, the city has really gone forward. We had a very difficult time with the Crossroads West, the shopping center, and the housing development, you know, trying to come together, having differences of opinion, and he was able to mediate between powerfully stubborn people. When we entertained the cannabis industry, the council, but also Mr. Scully, had to take a lot of beating, some of it physically. But when we did our due diligence, and that had turned out to be phenomenal. The advances we've done with Emetis at the LRA is truly remarkable. What you have delved out is will last us generations down the road. He doesn't look at the near term, he looks at the long term. In 2014, I was trying to get a tax sharing agreement with the county, and it was trying to get the other mayors, which is like herding cats, to come along and get the agreement. Once we got that agreed, I was trying to get the county to come and talks, and Sean goes, let me have this project. I'll get it through staff in short order. That was 2018. Oh, it was 19? Okay, so you've only had it 19, 20, 21, 3 years, and we still don't have a tax sharing agreement. But that's not a shortfall. We it's very difficult, and Sean, you've been truly a great leader here in the city. And before I do anything, anybody else want to say something supporting? Go ahead. You can do it from here or up there.
My comments when you're done, Mayor.
Okay, well, I'm done the comments. I'm now going to give them something. Yeah, please do. Okay.
So out of fear of getting emotional, because I tend to do that and tend to cry when I at events like this, when it means a lot, and I was kind of hoping to do it at the end of the meeting, but since we're kind of jumping into it now, let's go for it. Oh, no worries. So just a little brief history for Sean, those that don't know Sean Scully. So the Modesto Bee posted it November 16, 2016, that Riverbank had hired a new city manager from the city of Gustine, Sean Scully. And January of 2017, Sean attended his first city council meeting, sitting right where he's at right now. So I wouldn't meet Sean until, see, there he goes already. So I wouldn't meet Sean until January of 2018 when I walked into City Hall North, absolutely lost, looking for this thing called the council meeting. The first time we met, we kind of looked at each other with this familiarity. I don't know if you remember that, but it just I just thought we kind of maybe played basketball back in the day, you know, going off your height. But then we later realized we worked together at the Relay Center here, located in Riverbank. And back at that work, the terms we used at that job in kind of helping out the deaf, hard of hearing, and the speech disabled were over the phone were GA, go ahead, SKSK, stop keying. So those were the terms we would use back in the day. They kind of probably haunt Sean still to this day. They do me. And we would use that term SKSK to end the calls, right, when everything was done. So I'm standing there in the front office. Sean walked up to me, very welcoming, gave me the information to attend the first council meeting. I would end up attending the meetings because I enjoyed learning about how the government worked and everything like that. Sean's door was always open. He would point me in the right direction so I can continue to learn. And I think in a way, what I had going on in my personal life, and I've shared that with Sean, in retrospect, Sean had a little, you know, he had a part in my decision to actually run and go for it. He was kind of just showing me what it would be like to work side by side with a city manager before I was just as a resident. So that kind of built up the confidence, and so I decided to run later that year. As a member of the council, we would be creative in how we would prepare for agenda meetings. We would meet at gun ranges when we were discussing the downtown gun range. We would tour Jilton before we would handle the state mandate. So Sean brings out that creativity in people. Yes, it's true. We would exit one-on-one meetings with laughter, jokes that gave the impression that we were unproductive. But I was comfortable being myself around him. And Sean just made it easy. After a weekend of reading 400-page reports, like, Sean just let you be yourself. So I'm very proud of Sean, all the things he's accomplished. Knowing him, sky's the limit. Sean has so many accomplishments. I'm sure they'll be shared by the other council members. I'm sure the mayor will get into a little bit more, the Metis agreement. We can go on and on. But Sean's been like a brother to me. Sean claims he's from Jalisco, and seeing as his Spanish is slightly better than mine, so I'll let him have that since he's on his way out. Sean has improved every council member he has ever encountered, in my opinion, which helps brings legitimacy to that position, and which only benefits the Riverbank, the residents of that city. So good luck to you, to Bing, to Jonah, Alexander, and we'll be hanging out soon, SKSK.
Sure, come on down. Now, had they given me a presentation, could have done it right.
I'm Cal Campbell on the City Council, and I had the privilege of being on the committee that interviewed Sean for the position of the city manager. There were two other council members with me, and we were just really struck with him because he wanted to come to Riverbank. He didn't want to go anywhere but leave Gustine and come to Riverbank. Being to Gustine, I understand that. But he was here, and he's done a great job. He's wide open to his council members. He listens to ideas. He's not afraid to pursue those ideas, even though some of them might seem silly to him. But he's very good with staying in communication with his council. And whenever we've had other things and affairs, he's been well received there as a friend, and everybody gets along well with him. So I agree with the mayor, because I've been on this council since 2013, and we've come a long, long way in the 5 or 6 years that you've been with us, Sean, and gotten over a lot of bumps, and you can feel very good about that, because I'm tired of bumping on them, and we want to get rid of them. And the only thing I'm going to leave Sean with is, I know I'm going to see him again sometime, but one thing I failed with him, I couldn't teach him how to do a backflip off of my rock at my swimming pool. He just couldn't get it. So anyway, Sean, I want to wish you the best. I know you're going to do well there because of your personality, but we're going to miss you very much, and I wish you the best. Thank you.
I'd just like to say that Sean's been outstanding for the public. Anybody in the public that needed anything, he would take care of it. I know for me, anytime I had a question, I could call him and he'd take care of it. And for the citizens of Riverbank, he's been an outstanding city manager, a lot better than ones that I knew of when I was around here. So, Sean, I'd like to say for the citizens of Riverbank, you know, anything that you need, you know, just call on one of the citizens of Riverbank, and where you go, you'll be an outstanding city manager, and it won't take the people long to get to know you, and when they do, that they'll, you know, they will help you. I know you are. I'm not. I was just reading it. 2017, you came here, huh? Yeah, I remember when you came. Yep, you were sitting right back there when they said, you know, Sean Scully, we're gonna appoint him as the city manager. And I think not very long after that, you had a son. Yep, I remember that. Two. You got two now. Goodness. Maybe you better read this.
I better read it. Thank you. All right, Ms. Scully, could you come on down here? Although this is saying it's from the city council, is actually from the city. But the city, Riverbank City Council, takes pleasure in extending our gratitude to Sean Scully for superlative performance as Riverbank City Manager, displaying exemplary and highly professional skills in negotiating complex dealings with the state and local government agencies. His foresight and creative thinking resulted in improved strategies that will positively impact Riverbank for generations to come. His exceptional professional abilities, personal initiative, integrity, and intelligence contributed to the successes and the viability of our city. Thank you for your dedication and service. From January 2nd, 2017 to January 14th, 2022. Sean, thank you very much.
I had written something up because I'm not very good at this for the other meeting, but I might as well read it now so we can just get to business. hoping to wait so I could not be a baby, but so I'll keep this brief. I didn't want the opportunity to pass without having the ability to express my gratitude. to this council, staff, team, and community for allowing me to serve. I can tell you with all honesty that it has been some of the most professionally rewarding years of my life. I'm tremendously proud and humbled to have been part of this team and to generate so much success with this team over this period of time. I've truly grown to love Riverbank. Although working as a public servant, as we speak about here at the dais quite a bit, can be a very frustrating and stressful experience, I can honestly say that I've loved virtually every moment of it. I came here seeking an aggressive community that wanted to get things done. I came looking for a city council that was open to opportunities and allowed staff the flexibility to come up with creative solutions to the challenges we faced. And I got just that. And now that I think about it, I probably got more of that than I knew I wanted. I'm very grateful that the city council has chosen Maricela to take over. She is, in every sense of the word, a true professional. I know that she will serve this community with all of her heart, just as she has for over two decades. Your staff, similarly, will continue to do what they do day in and day out, and that is to provide the best in services to this community. And I've been very appreciative of being able to be part of that staff team. So thank you to every one of the staff out there. Thank you to the community. Riverbank is a place that always has been special and unique and is becoming even more so year in and year out. It's no wonder everybody wants to move here. So we're having these discussions about housing all the time. But finally, and perhaps foremost, I want you to know that I'm going to look back on my time here with pride and gratitude. And so to be very clear, I'd like to thank each and every council member, past and present, that I've had the pleasure of serving. You truly have made this responsibility a special experience. For every bit of advice that I've offered, you have each imparted wisdom, support, and direction exactly when needed. Riverbank is very fortunate to have this group of elected officials who put this calling above so many other things in their personal lives. It is true and honorable service, and you should be proud. I wish you all the best and look forward to following your many collective achievements in the future. Thank you.
Thank you. Wait a minute, no, you're not done. The plaque is something you hang on your I Love Me wall, and you see it from time to time. So the council decided that here's something that you're going to use daily.
Do you want me to open?
Yes.
Okay.
Oh, gosh.
That's true. Any good city manager has to have these. These are a wine decanter and wine tumblers, which I don't know what that says about me, but I think you can probably guess. Thank you very much.
And when you have a chance to open it, there are some initials on it.
Oh, they're okay.
So with that, I want to thank you. And you said his door was always open, but every time I came by,
it was closed. That's why you have to have the office in the back. Thank you, Mayor.
Mayor?
Yes.
Hi, this is Darlene, Councilmember Barbara Martinez. I am not there because I'm not feeling well, neither is my husband. But anyway, I just wanted to, Sean, just to let you know that I always want you to have the best, and thank you for all of your leadership. Thank you for being more than just a council and a friend to me and my family, my organization. We really appreciate you as a person. So thank you for everything and always wishing you the best. And you know, whenever I met a council member from Gustine, they would always say, oh, you guys are so lucky to have Sean. I'm like, yeah, we know it. Mm-hmm, thank you. But now I guess I have to say the same thing to Lincoln. And I'm jealous that that's where you're going to be. But anyway, wishing you the best. And it's a privilege to have, they'll say the same thing. It'll be a privilege to have you in their city. So always the best to you. Thank you.
Thank you all. All right, moving on. Presentations, do we have presentation from StanCOG on regional transportation plan and sustainable community strategy? Okay.
Thank you, Mayor. Isidro here. Could you all hear me?
Yes.
Yes, okay. Good evening. Again, my name is Isidro. I'm a senior planner at the Stanislaus Council of Governments. Thank you for allowing me to present on the Stanislaus Council of Governments 2022 Regional Transportation Plan and Sustainable Community Strategy tonight. I will now share my screen to show the presentation. Give me a moment. A little background on StanCOG and what we do. Stanislaus Council of Governments is governed by a decision-making body called the Policy Board. Policy Board is comprised of 16 elected officials from StanCOG member agencies. This includes 5 representatives from the Stanislaus County Board of Supervisors, 3 representatives from Modesto City Council, and 1 representative from each of the other 8 city councils in Stanislaus County. The city of Riverbank has a representative on the StanCOG board, and that's Mayor O'Brien. He is the vice chair of the StanCOG policy board. Before we move on to the next slide, I did want to thank Mayor O'Brien and the Riverbank staff, Kathleen Cleek and Donna Kenny, for assisting during this update of the 2022 RTPSES. We appreciate the staff's input during the development of our listing of regional transportation projects for inclusion in the plan. So thank you and your staff. This slide shows the agenda. Very quickly, we'll talk about the project outreach that we've done and are continuing to do, an overview of the RTPSES, the goals that were set by the Valley Vision Stanislaus Steering Committee, the scenario development that's currently taking place, and also the next steps. Every 4 years, the Stanislaus Council of Governments is required to update the regional transportation plan and sustainable community strategy. This is a planning effort that requires close coordination with our planning partners at the federal, state, and local levels. And as I mentioned, we've been working very closely with the 9 cities and county of Stanislaus during this update. Today's presentation is one of many outreach activities that are being held in support of the update of the RTPSES. The major elements of the outreach include the StanCOG's Valley Vision Stanislaus Steering Committee, which includes representation from all of the cities and unincorporated county. Donna Kenny has played a very important role on the committee, as she is the vice chair of the Valley Vision Stanislaus Steering Committee and has provided tremendous support in that capacity. We're also doing outreach to city councils, as we're doing today, to the rest of the region. We're also presenting to the County Board of Supervisors, StanCOG's bike, pedestrian, citizens, and other advisory committees. We've already held 2 rounds of community workshops where we sought input from the community-based organizations in the area, business leaders, and members of the public. Very important aspect of our public workshops and community outreach is that the presentations and workshops have been available in Spanish and English, and we're continuing to do that to encourage participation from all of Stanislaus County residents. We also have an interactive website that I'll show you a little bit later, where we allow members of the public to register to receive regular emails so they are aware of upcoming events. The website also hosts a survey and information on public meetings and other useful information. That's the website you see on the bottom, valleyvision2046.com. So what is a RTPSES, or a Regional Transportation Plan and Sustainable Community Strategy? It is the long-range transportation plan for the region. One of the most important elements of the plan is that list of transportation projects that your agency and all other agencies in the region are planning to implement between now and the next 25 years. One of the first steps, as I mentioned, was working with your staff to collect that list of projects for the city of Riverbank and all the other cities in the region and the county. Its preparation is mandated by both the federal government and the state of California, and it must cover a horizon of at least 20 years in the future and be updated every 4 years. Our RTPSES is covering 25 years, so it's going all the way to 2046. One of the most important features of the plan is that it reflects a shared vision of the cities in South Los County for a transportation system that meets its residents' needs. So it must clearly connect to plan land uses and development and reflect goals for housing and employment in the region. It's important to note that this is a programmatic document, so it's not focused on any one transportation project. It's more focused on how the transportation pieces fit together rather than any individual project. Individual projects are handled during another process outside of this plan. This planning effort is closely coordinated from guidance of the Valley Vision Stanislaus Steering Committee, comprised of the 10 local agency planning representatives and other interest groups. This plan must be multimodal, meaning it must consider planned roadway, transit, bike and pedestrian, and also aviation projects. This plan must be fiscally constrained, meaning that planned expenses over the next 25 years for the transportation cannot be more than we expect to receive on transportation projects. The plan must also meet federal standards for air quality and also must meet the California targets for greenhouse gas emission reductions to combat climate change. The sustainable communities strategy element of the plan details how regions can achieve these greenhouse gas emission reduction targets set forth by the California Air Resources Board to combat those climate change goals and air quality goals. The plan must also comply with CEQA, with the California Environmental Quality Act, which focuses on making sure that we understand and address any potential negative environmental impacts that might result from the plan. On the screen, you can see some goals that were set in early December by the Valley Vision Stanislaus Steering Committee. These are 11 that they set. These cover a variety of important federal, state, and local considerations. Briefly, some of the goals include improving the ability of people and goods to move via a variety of mobility options. There's goals in there about minimizing impacts of clean air and natural resources. And then also efficiently using transportation funding is also one of them. The full list and the details on the list is available on the valleyvision2046.com website. The scenario guiding principles are being used to generate four different scenarios. An important part of our approach to developing the RTP-SES is using a scenario analysis approach that develops a long-range solution to meet state and federal requirements, while also improving the quality of life in Stanislaus County. We're currently working with the Valley Vision Stanislaus Steering Committee on developing four distinct scenarios that emphasize different growth patterns based on the following guiding principles that are shown on your screen. They include ensuring a jobs housing balance, encouraging growth in areas where the total annual miles of vehicle travel are already low, preserving farmland, increasing access to opportunity for everyone, including low and minority populations, and also encouraging infill growth. These guiding principles will help us ensure that the scenarios meet the greenhouse gas emission reduction targets and also the regional housing needs objectives and agricultural preservation goals that are very important to this county. As I mentioned, we're currently analyzing the scenarios to see how they perform against each other and also against the state targets for greenhouse gas emission reduction and also the national ambient air quality federal standards. We anticipate presenting the draft scenario results to the Valley Vision Stanislaus Steering Committee in February for its consideration. And in March, we'll be doing some outreach to local stakeholder groups, including those that represent low-income and minority populations. We anticipate holding the third round of public and stakeholder meetings in March. Once the results of the scenario analysis have been analyzed and we have a scenario that meets state and federal requirements, we'll be asking the Valley Vision Stanislaus Steering Committee to help select a preferred alternative at that time. We will then develop the draft regional transportation plan and prepare an environmental impact analysis and report, and we'll post the draft documents on our website for public review. There will also be two formal public hearings anticipated in late spring, and StanCOG and our staff will address public comments on the plan, and we'll be bringing that back to the policy board for consideration of approval around the summer this year. On the screen, you can see a snip or a screen capture of our valleyvision2046.com website. Some important information that's on there currently that we want to let you know as well is that we're holding a virtual environmental impact report scoping meeting on this Thursday, January 13th from 12 o'clock to 1 o'clock. More information on how to access that, we're doing that through Zoom. There's a Zoom link and number on there on our project website that contains that information and also other information such as past presentations, our goals and objectives that I mentioned earlier, and other important information. Also on this website, if you want to stay in the loop as the project moves along, please do register to receive notification through the Valley Vision 2046 website, or if you have any questions with the website or any of its contents, my contact information is on the screen below and you should also have it. That concludes my presentation tonight. Again, I want to thank you for your time. I want to thank you for allowing me to make this presentation, and I'm available for any questions should you have any at this time.
Council, do you have any questions?
Isael, I just got one question. Maybe you can just kind of educate me on the scenario for the growing the infill areas. So we have an area on 108. How do you, what project makes that list? Is there like a priority list to it?
So when we talk about, we're more talking about the land use when we're talking about these different SES scenarios. They all come with their different transportation elements, but at this point we're focused on what land use considerations or land use strategies we could use to meet those greenhouse gas emission reduction targets. So we're focused on keeping keeping growth as intense as we can feasibly, and then also not going past the city boundaries, not going past and not eating too much of the very important farmland that we have in our region. Those different types of strategies is what we're focusing on right now to make sure that we get a scenario or a suite of scenarios that we could actually use and allow the VBS to select from. We do have increased targets this time around. I know the mayor's very, he's been the chair in past cycles, and he's very familiar with the process and the targets that we barely met last time, and they were increased this time. So we're gonna have to go even more intensify than we did on our last round of SES, which was already pushing the envelope quite a bit, but we have to do whatever we can to meet those targets to keep this SES approved. And what we're doing is we're developing, like I mentioned, four scenarios. They're all different, but let me go back to the slide. You were mentioning growth in infill areas. So I know there we've met with all the local agencies on their current land use situations and where they think we have an availability to grow in these infill areas. I know it's somewhat limited, but there are a lot of areas in each city that we're taking advantage of and planning for that in our scenarios. So it's not really about the transportation projects that fit that scenario at this point. Right now we're focused on getting the land use scenarios and letting us analyze that and see how much VMT could be reduced and correspondingly how much the greenhouse gas emissions off of those VMT numbers can be decreased as well.
Okay, thank you, Sayo.
You're talking about the one across from the theater? That has land use already associated with it. Any other questions for StanCOG? Okay, thank you very much. Look
thank
forward
you,
to working with you again.
Thank you all.
All right, with that, we go to the consent calendar consisting of item 9.1, waive readings. Item 92A, September 14th, 2021, City Council and Local Redevelopment Authority Board Minutes. Item 92B, the October 26th, 2021, City Council and Local Redevelopment Authority Board Minutes. Items 92C, the November 3rd, 2021, Special City Council Minutes. 92D, the November 9th, 2021, City Council and Local Redevelopment Authority Board Minutes. Item 92E, the December 7th, 2021, Special City Council Minutes. And 92F, the December 14th, 2021, City Council and Local Redevelopment Authority Board Minutes. Do I have anyone wishing to pull any of these items? Do I have a recommendation from the council?
I'll make a motion that we accept the consent calendar as so stated.
I'll second it.
We have a motion to approve and a second on the consent calendar.
Council authority members, Barbara Martinez.
Yes.
Campbell.
Yes.
Hernandez.
Yes.
Vice Mayor Chair Uribe.
Yes.
Mayor Chair O'Brien.
Yes.
Motion passes 5-0.
Item 10-1, Riverbank Energy Efficiency Project Direction on Funding Strategy and Final Project Scope with SiteLogIQ.
Good evening, Mayor and Council. So I'm very excited to hopefully give you a little bit of background and some options to bring this project to fruition. We've been working on this for many months now, and it's quite a project, and I think it has the opportunity to really be something that's special for the community for many years, not only from a energy efficiency perspective, but also a way for the city to save money on its power costs and lead the way in continuing to look for alternative energy sources to power operations. So Jessica from SiteLogIQ is on the line. I'm going to hold going to her just for a moment because we'll do that if council needs to ask detailed questions or go back over the project. I think we've talked about it enough that that's not necessary. In brief, remember that it includes solar arrays at the police department parking lot, the community center parking lot, Wharton Park, the wastewater treatment facility, and also includes HVAC replacement to efficient units, as well as efficient lighting replacement throughout all of our facilities. So once the council approved the letter of agreement with SiteLogIQ on August 24th, SiteLogIQ has basically been very busy doing engineering on the project. So in a sense, putting the documents together that will be necessary to actually build this project. Generally, that's been pretty simple, except for the wastewater plant. And one of the things we learned when design commenced was the area that is most appropriate for these solar arrays at the plant is actually over the top of a very old, more than 30 years, probably even more than 40 years old landfill that has been capped and dirt has been put over it. And it's something that even some of our staff were not aware of that existed. So the concern, obviously, is we don't know what's below that dirt. We know that the capped landfill does not begin until about 5 feet below grade. And so it was an interesting and kind of complicated engineering puzzle for SiteLogIQ to figure out how do we construct a fairly large solar array at that location without puncturing the ground, because 5 feet really isn't all that much room, and you certainly do not want to penetrate what's in the landfill, because we don't know what it is. So we'd rather just stay away from it. So SiteLogIQ actually came up with a very interesting and clever solution, which they have used on other projects, which essentially sort of floats these solar arrays, where they basically will construct them with concrete blocks and lay them over the top of this area. And it does not require any type of actual anchoring into the ground. And if this follow-up concern that, you know, I had, and I think that most people, reasonable people would have, is that what about the weight of these solar arrays? Is it going to depress the ground to a point where we're actually creating a different kind of problem? And the answer to that is no. What I'm told by their engineers is that the way that they spread the weight out over these columns is that essentially it creates about 2 to 3 pounds of pressure per foot, or maybe it's per square inch. I'll have to have Jessica to say that. But not enough to depress the ground in that area. So it looks like it's going to work. It increased the project cost just a little bit, but because we were able to add in some additional HVAC units, what you're going to see when you've looked at the cash flow that I'll get into in a moment is some very attractive cumulative savings. So the two pieces of direction we need to get this started, and by the way, one last thing, SiteLogIQ has submitted our interconnection agreement with PG&E, so we're good to go there. No issues if they decide to change the rules moving forward, at least for this project. So the two pieces of direction that we staff is seeking this evening is project. First, we need council to just once and hopefully for all define the project from the following two options: the original project, which I just outlined for you, and then staff, at the request of the mayor and council, also looked into a microgrid option at the community center, and we also looked into additional lighting options for either street lights or scout hall. Let me answer the lighting options question first, and then we'll go back to the microgrid. SiteLogIQ basically did quite a bit of research on different options that we have. Their general feedback to us, though, was that in terms of the project paying for itself, it is not efficient to have, like, if we were going to basically redo all of the lights in town at all of our facilities and add additional lighting, there might be some economies of scale. But because, if you take the Scout Hall, for example, because it's lighting deficient as it exists today, you don't really provide any savings when you invest in new lighting there because you're not offsetting current power cost. So the suggestion was, look, we think you should look into that, and we think you should probably look into solar and alternative methods at those facilities, but it's probably most financially beneficial to you to just do that during your normal budgeting process. With regard to the microgrid, that project added roughly $1 million, I think, to the total project cost. And what they found as they did their research was that the problem isn't wiring for that. That can be done as part of this project. The problem is battery technology, and it's simply just very expensive still to run, to buy these types of batteries that would need to house enough power to keep that facility running. Their suggestion to us was to outside of the project, or perhaps you use some of the So to break it down in a really simple way, let's assume that we budget $50,000 a year for power for the community center. I'm making these numbers up, but you'll see in the cash flow sheet that there's plenty of savings depending on how you decide to account for them. If you budget $50,000 a year for the community center and you're only going to be spending $25,000 a year in power costs after this project, including debt service, including everything else, the net savings is $25,000, let's just say, at that location. It may be a better idea for council to, instead of, since you will eventually bring down that budget to match whatever your actual power costs are, to take whatever the delta is on that portion of the project and set it aside into either a deferred maintenance account or a different capital account, and use those funds to purchase a new generator, and as it's financially feasible, batteries to run the facility. Because there's no question that because of the amount of outages we have in the PG&E territory of Riverbank and all the natural disasters that seem to occur more frequently, that facility will be used at some point. as an emergency, overflow. And so there's real value there. I just think that we think that the easiest way to do it from a financial perspective is to realize the savings under this project and use some of those revenues to carry forward the microgrid. So decision number one is, do we, and you'll also see on the cash flow sheets that I included in your report, that the project option two, which is with the microgrid, brings down, you still save money, but the problem is that cumulatively for the first 20 years, you lose, you'll be spending a little bit more in debt service and overall power costs until you hit that 20-year mark, which is when your payments stop, and then you start to really realize the savings. The attractiveness of project option one is that you, depending on which ARPA level, you immediately receive cumulative savings beginning of immediately year one. So that's first decision is, do we stick with the original project or do we add on some of these other components? The second part, which I don't think really requires all that much discussion, it's all in the cash flow sheets that have been included in your report. I asked SiteLogIQ to basically give us three options. ARPA contribution at $1 million and the rest financed, ARPA contribution at $2 million or 31% of the project cost and the rest financed, and ARPA contribution at $3 million or 45% of the project cost and the rest financed. To get past all of the nitty-gritty, just brass tacks here, the estimated savings under the $1 million option is $7.74 million over a 30-year period. However, you will not have a positive cumulative cash flow until year 17, meaning you will be spending more money than you are currently spending on power, even with escalation, for 17 years until that switches the other direction. And those last 13 years, you save a lot of money because you're not paying any debt service for the last 10, but in the 17-year period up to then, it actually kind of represents a negative cash flow for the city, which is not recommended. Project option number two, which is the $2 million, is our recommended option. We think it's the most conservative while also giving us a very good return. You'll see at $2 million, the total estimated savings over a 30-year period is a little over $9 million. The thing we really like about this is it immediately has a positive cash flow. There's no point at which under the entire 30-year term where cumulatively you don't have a positive cash flow on the project, which is, Maricela can tell you from a finance perspective is awesome. Option three is $3 million, and you'd think, and I thought, that putting a whole nother third down payment essentially into this project would really balloon up your estimated savings, but it doesn't really do that much. It actually it almost is a dollar for dollar. You save about $10.3 million over the 30 years. For the $1 million you're using today in 30-year dollars, from now dollars, I don't see it as being beneficial enough when you could use that $1 million today on some other important thing in the city. Final thing, and then I'll take any questions. The Treasury has just I think yesterday or the day before issued their final rule on ARPA dollars, which is very positive for the city of Riverbank. Basically, it says that it used to be that you had to justify your loss in order to access those dollars for general fund purposes. So it was a complicated calculation that Maricela had to do to figure out what our revenues could have been and should have been. They eliminated all of that up to a point. So basically now what they're saying is cities can basically assume, with no documentation, a $10 million loss during COVID. So what that means is the city literally, for the $5.8 million that you receive from ARPA, is literally unrestricted. And Maricela, if you're out there somewhere, you can jump in and correct me on that, but it's generally unrestricted, and you could absorb all of that into your general fund and use it for a general purpose. So that, I'm just mentioning that because it should color the conversation here. I still think that this investment is wise because there are so few things that you can do that will save you revenue over the long term and also line up with your collective desire to find alternative energy sources. So that's really my recommendation. Our recommendation would be to keep the project generally as it was originally anticipated and fund at the $2 million level. And if that is the direction given this evening or not, either way, your direction will then push us forward to the next step, which is we have lined up bond representation, and they'll start to put together those documents for council to approve. And then maybe Jessica, just to kind of close out, because I've been talking a long time here, could you talk a little bit about what your anticipated construction schedule is?
Absolutely. Actually, Sean, I want to punt that over to Dr. Eddie Jordan here. He's the director of our project development. He can answer that question a little bit better than I can.
Good. Thanks, Jessica and Scott. Once the project is, the contract is signed and it is funded through the Texas Municipalities or whatever funding mechanism we end up moving forward with, construction will start approximately 6 months after that date and then be completed about a year and 3 months after that point. The reason being, there is some due diligence. The reason it's a little longer than normal, there is some due diligence that needs to be done, like was mentioned, at the landfill. We have to be very careful and smart in how we do that installation due to the cap on that landfill.
And so that pretty much wraps it up. The sooner that we can go to market with the financing package, the better. As you probably have read, the rates are starting to creep up, and so we want to avoid that if possible. So happy to answer any questions you might have.
I just have a comment. There's also additional funding out there that's through the Infrastructure Investment and Jobs Act. I was supposed to meet with the Deputy Secretary of the Department of Energy next week, but Washington is shutting down, and she is not available. But she has funding available for clean energy and projects like ours. So when I do get a chance to go back to D.C., I will, again, get an appointment with her and bring our project forward, especially for the batteries for the community center. The concept of the community center is to have a 24-hour available power that you off the grid, and that when there are emergencies, such as we saw in Sonora area, Jamestown fire, they had displaced people, they could use our community center that has the cooling system and be able to be in there for a while. And just across the way, just what 50 yards at the most, is the pool for bathing, and so it's a win-win in that area. And I think if we market all of our green spots that we're doing, I think that will make a bigger impact when we present it to those who have additional funding. So for the power, for the battery backup, that is my plan, to see if I can get the cash just to go ahead and buy it.
I'd like to make a comment. First, if I'm not mistaken, our governor wants to do away with all gasoline generators by 2024. And so I'm concerned if we get a generator, how that's going to fit that scenario if he continues with it. I'm not against it. I just don't want to suspend it if we have to say can't use it, because it wouldn't do the trick. The other thing is, if you've been watching what's happened up in the mountains with PG&E, and this seems to be the scenario that's going on with PG&E every time there's a disaster, and I think the mayor really has a great idea about getting some energy into that community center for any emergency that we have. And I'd like to see us even look at more solar eventually throughout the city, because my feelings are that PG&E is having a hard time struggling with these disasters that are coming on, and they just keep stacking up. They get out of one and another one happens. So we need to protect our community by having our own energy sources that can still be, keep this community going. So I'd like to look at it in that way. And Sean, can you clarify for me the real difference between 2 and 3 for the financing again? I didn't quite get that.
Sure. So at $2 million ARPA contribution, your cumulative savings is not $9.05 million. At $3 million ARPA contribution, your cumulative savings is $10.3 million. So you do save more over a 30-year term with a $3 million option. My point is that I don't, let's say you have $30 million in ARPA, then sure, it probably makes sense for you to use an extra million here. But since you only have $5.8 million in ARPA, I was hesitant to recommend that you use more than half of that on just one thing, because there will be other things. And now that it's generally unrestricted, there's all kinds of options for you. So I think $2 million is sort of the sweet spot of a project that pays for itself, and you're not totally depleting ARPA.
Thank you.
May I respond to your comment about generators, diesel generators? That's stationary. Mm-hmm. If you have a portable one that can provide you the backup power, that's not under that.
Okay, that's good.
Until later on. So if the need to get rid of the larger stationary diesel generators or diesel engines is great in the valley. So a portable one work in emergencies, and that would be our backup until we can get batteries installed.
That's correct, Mayor. And one more thing I didn't mention is if you look at the cash flow sheets, one super important item is there's two columns that says future HVAC replacement cost and future lighting replacement cost. SiteLogIQ has budgeted in almost $800,000 total during this 30-year term, where we are accounting for money we should be putting aside to replace these HVAC units and these lighting fixtures that we're putting in today. Because, you know, certainly one of the questions is, well, look, these lights aren't going to last 30 years, and that's correct, they're not. And so we've accounted for that and for the air conditioning units within this budget. So as you're looking at the total savings, that includes replacing some of those units at lighting at year 10 and HVAC, I think, at year 15. And we actually, you know, Sue could tell you, we have plenty of units that are up on the roof right now that are a lot older than 15 years old.
Okay, so I'll make a couple comments. So I know the commission is going to be voting on January 27th to whether or not they're going to be changing that net energy metering. So it's good if we do jump in now to be grandfathered into that 2.0 tariff versus the less friendly, as Jessica put it, less friendly 3.0 rates. So PG&E's escalation rate, and I'm being conservative, is like 5%. It's probably going to be more. Probably it's depending. Regardless, if we move forward with this project, the PG&E rates are going to go up. So I think the two portable generators being bought separately. We did lose power in City Hall South and North. With our servers going down, it's all the business kind of paused. So I think that is a problem. We do got to address that. I think we do have to set it up so we are wired for the microgrid down the future. And if the mayor can get some funding from DC, I think that's the way to go. That way we can kind of wait for that battery technology to kind of catch up to what we're trying to do here. And then as we see the savings from the PG&E, I think it's important that we kind of budget those savings for the microgrid at the community center. So I'd like to see us go towards the original option one, investing that $2 million. Thank you.
Darlene?
Okay, so I thought it was option two.
Yes, I did too.
Instead of option one. Option two, where we invested $2 million. And I think that I like the fact that we do get a chance to see the immediate cash flow. And I just think that's the way that we should move forward. Thank you.
Yeah, do we want to make a motion today or just providing direction?
I need to do public comment.
Right. Option two.
Okay. All right. Thank you. I'm going to open it up to the public for comment. Do we have anyone on Zoom comment?
There is no one wishing to speak.
Anyone from the public here wishing to speak? I bring it back to council. I think this is a good way to invest for, what, 30 years? It's going to be longer than that. Your power panels are, or solar panels are rated at 25 years, but they can, that's at a certain percentage, and they'll degrade further down the road, and that's going to be another area of, not concern, but of investment in the future. But we will show that we have made a tremendous amount of savings no matter what option we take. But I'm going to bring it to the council for consideration.
So before I make a motion, I just wanted to clarify. So I was leaning towards the project option one, finance option two for the $2 million. So that was where maybe I got confused. So I'll make a motion. Do I need to announce both or just project option one, finance option two? Is that how?
Yes.
Yes.
So I'll make a motion for project option one, finance option two.
I'll second.
We have a motion for finance option one and option two on the ARPA funding. Project option and finance option.
Council members, Barbara Martinez.
Yeah.
Campbell.
Yes.
Hernandez.
Yes.
Mayor Dive.
Yes.
Chair O'Brien.
Yes.
Motion passes 5-0.
All right, thank you. Hey, Jessica, thank you. Good presentations throughout the initial stages. And Eddie, thank you very much. And thank staff for bringing us along.
Thank you guys so much for your trust. And Sean, it has been an immense pleasure working with you. So good luck on your journeys going forward, and hopefully we'll get to see you in Lincoln.
Thank you very much. Okay, we'll move on to new business. Item 11.1, nomination and appointment of the vice mayor to serve for the year 2022. I have full faith and confidence in all the members on this dais. And it's never easy because I think I offend some people or not, but Luis, you've done a great job, and Darlene, you have done a great job. You are someday going to do a great job, but I would like to have Cal Campbell serve his last year on the council as the vice mayor.
Yeah. I would appreciate doing that.
Okay. So, with that, I think I will make a motion to appoint Councilmember Cal Campbell as vice mayor for the year 2022.
And I
should offer comments first. Any comments from the council? Any comments from the public?
There is no one wishing to speak.
Thank you. Bring it back.
And I'll second it.
Okay. Roll call, please.
Councilmembers Barbara Martinez.
Yes.
Campbell.
Yes.
Hernandez.
Yes.
Vice Mayor Dive.
Yes.
Mayor O'Brien.
Yes.
Motion passes 5-0.
Thank you all. When do we appoint for committees? Is that next meeting?
Yes.
Okay. All right. 12.1, staff comments.
thank you, Mayor and Council. I actually was going to read what I said earlier just now, but I don't need to do that again. So I guess I'll just leave you with this. It's been a pleasure and a lot of fun. I know it seems strange, but I really enjoyed the work. And so thank you to you. Thank you to my partner over here to my right, who has consistently put out professional work with me for 5 years. And every, just so you know, the city clerk, city manager relationship is sort of special because we're always feel like we're on deadline all the time. And she's made it really easy. And then, of course, the person hiding in the corner, Norma, who kind of runs the show. So I and the rest of the staff here, I could go through each and every one of them, but the good news about that is that you already know each of them and how valuable they are. And so thank you for letting me lead them. And look forward to zooming in or at least watching on YouTube when Maricela is sitting in this chair next meeting, and I know she's really excited out there somewhere. So, one actual real business item just for the community. We have been getting nonstop phone calls about more tests, more rapid tests. I wish we could give you more rapid tests. We've asked the county. Right now, it sounds like they're basically dry in terms of tests. As soon as they come in, we'll be continuing to check with them, and we will do another giveaway. As many as necessary until it's no longer necessary, just like we did with masks. Even sourcing tests, if we were to purchase them ourselves, is really tough because they're kind of like masks where they're getting the prices are being inflated all over the place. So we will put that out to the community as soon as we can, and then get those into the hands of the people that need them. And that's all I have. Thank you.
Thank you, Councilmember Campbell.
I would like to thank the council members for giving me the trust of being the vice mayor for this next year. And I'd like everyone to know that I will do my best to serve your purposes and help the mayor to get his job done better. And whatever I can do that, I will do as much as I can. And I appreciate it very much. Thank you.
Councilmember Hernandez.
I didn't make comments before because I thought I was going to get emotional, and I think I will again right now, so I'll keep it short. I don't think I mentioned it, but when I was being sworn in virtually, I noticed that Sean got emotional when he was saying goodbye to the previous council member, and my first thoughts were like, oh my gosh, like what did I do? Like maybe I shouldn't have done that. And I wasn't sure how the relationship was going to be, but I realized soon that you just care, you know, deeply about everything and everybody. So I admire your character and what you've done for the council and what you've done for me in this last year. So I appreciate it. Thank you.
Thank you, Vice Mayor.
Thank you, Mayor. Can you guys hear me? So Kiwi's Custom Guns shooting range will be holding a small groundbreaking ceremony this Thursday the 13th at 11 a.m. So it's always exciting to see businesses expand, especially in our downtown area. The League of California Cities subcommittees are starting back up, so I'm excited to start my fourth year on the Revenue and Taxation Subcommittee. The first meeting will be this Thursday as well. And the first Stanislaus 2030 Elected Officials webinar will be January 20th at 1:30 p.m., so I look forward to sitting in and listening to the economic opportunity discussions and bringing any ideas back to Riverbank. Thank you.
Thank you. Councilmember Barbara Martinez.
Okay, so the Riverbank Chamber of Commerce has new leadership, and we are planning on a business expo on February the 24th, and details will be coming soon. And we will be having our Stanislaus Homeless Alliance meeting. I just want to thank the, that will be this week. Also in the staff meeting, I want to thank the county for all their services and also our community service resource deputy Zong for coming out and assisting and providing services to our homeless population. January 17th is our Martin Luther King Day, and I just want to leave you with a quote from Dr. King himself, which is, everybody can be great because anybody can serve. You don't have to have a college degree to serve. You don't have to make your subject and verb agree to serve. You only need a heart full of grace, a soul generated by love. And I think that I'd like to leave that with you because all of our council members really do love our city. We love our residents, We love what we do as a council. So I just want to say thank you to all of you. And I'm also looking forward to a very promising new year. Shine again, the best. Thank you.
Thank you. Before I wish you the best, there's a couple of things that I'd like to have updated on before you leave. One is I'd like to have the Stanislaus Opportunity Stanislaus event out at the LRA again. And I believe you're working on that, so if we can get some type. And I'd like to have that coordinated with the Metis and Circulus, just so we, and Riverbank Organics, we can now showcase this is where we are going. And we may even get some state officials at that event. The second is, before you leave, I'd like to have an update on tax sharing agreement.
I'm very sorry, Mayor. So to answer your question, I don't have an update, but I will provide you a full written report before I leave of where we're at and to the rest of the council. Annabelle just mentioned to me that Maricela tried to raise her hand during staff comments, so I don't know if you want to.
Oh, I can stop. And Maricela, go ahead. We need you to unmute yourself. Lower left corner.
I don't think she is muted.
There.
Mm-hmm.
You there?
Hello?
There.
Oh, there we go. Okay. Well, I just wanted to take the opportunity on behalf of the City of Riverbank staff to thank Sean for his leadership, his mentorship, and most importantly, his friendship. He's leaving behind a trail of tears that we will all be collecting here, but we thank you so much for elevating the professionalism amongst all of the staff. You have truly pulled together a team that the City Council can be proud of, and for that, we thank you very much. Thank you very much for all of the wonderful memories you're leaving us with, and we wish you the best in Lincoln. They are extremely lucky to have you now, and that's all I wanted to say. So in the future, you know that we're here anytime you need us, and I hope I can call you anytime whenever I need an update on something you may have been working on.
Yeah, and finally, I know between you and Maricela, when do I get the year-end report?
We are working on it. There were some staff, including myself, that didn't have their reports in quite on time, and I won't say who those were, but I was one of them, and so it's almost compiled. One of my last assignments from Maricela is to write up a little letter as the intro, so you'll get it, and it'll be a good one. It's been a kind of an interesting year with a lot of accomplishments that are pretty exciting. So,
It is. Okay, with that, we are not going to go into closed session. I was told during the meeting, I'm sorry that I was told during the meeting, that we do not have a need to go to closed session. Is that true, Maricela?
That is true, Mayor.
Okay.
We do not have any updates yet, as we will begin negotiations with the labor groups in the month of February. So we will have an update for you this next meeting on the 25th.
Okay, thank you very much. With that, our next meeting will be on January 25th at 6 p.m. We are now adjourned.